Good afternoon, everyone. I'm Silakshna, host for this webinar on behalf of Wadhwani Foundation, Excellent Entrepreneurship Network. I'm so pleased to be with you and to have the chance to introduce our speaker, Mr. Ishwar Jha. Ishwar is the founder of CEO of Appetels. He works closely with clients to mold their ideas into a distinct product, such as web software and mobile applications built on ethics, speed, and the boldness of entrepreneurship. As a thought leader, writer, speaker, and teacher of cutting-edge corporate innovations within digital product development, digital media, and content platform, Ishwar is a master at his craft. Over the years, he has advised countless global corporations as well as entrepreneurs at the beginning of their craft, looking to excel in their field, which led to the idea development of product launch sprint and idea to IPO strategies. As we begin the session, I'd like to take you through the phenomenal job that WFNEN is doing in supporting startups, early stage and growth stage entrepreneurs and SMEs to grow their business. They provide a great free mentoring and learning platform to those who come and register at WFNEN.org and connect them to experienced and expert mentors along with Investor Connect. The mechanism is a very straightforward approach with goal-based, time-bound, and structured mentoring. Enrich yourself connecting to 400-plus mentors from various fields of work and make a difference. Request participants to mute audio appliances. After the presentation, we would have a discussion session for around 20 minutes where Ishwar would answer your questions. So please send me relevant questions over chat, which would be answered at the end of the session. I'd love to have your feedback on today's session. Your input and suggestions for future sessions are invaluable to me. So please leave your feedback on the poll at the end of the session. Without further ado, please join me in welcoming Ishwar Jha. Over to you, Ishwar.
Yes. Good afternoon, everyone, and welcome to the session on Demystifying Unique Selling Proposition. I have been introduced by Sulakshana just now, and I have been working with the entrepreneur space for almost a decade now, and I have created half a dozen companies as a part of my association with the SL Group under G Telephones with Suhas Chandra. And from 2010, I have launched three companies, exited two successfully, and right now I am running my third company. What I am going to do during today's session is going to tell you about how you can demystify the unique selling proposition. Today, when every day, when you face your customer, the first word that customer would be asking you, what is your USP? And if you can explain your USP in less than 10 seconds, that's what will make the first impression or first registration in the mind of a customer that whether you are there to solve the problem that he is facing in life or in business, or in general, in a meaningful way or not. So value proposition is very, very powerful. Unique selling proposition is a very, very powerful statement, and it helps you create your first registration in, or a first impression in the mind of a customer. I think I have just given you a little bit brief about who I am, what I do. So I have been CIO of a Sony, then I joined G as a CTO, and then gradually became the CEO and head of their digital business for the entire group. I spoke to you about my entrepreneurial journey of 18 years, and then last 6 years I'm an entrepreneur myself. I am here to touch lives of 1 million young students to nurture them to become employable. That's my first goal. And I am here to connect, coach, and mentor 10,000 entrepreneurs to augment a generation of entrepreneurs in India. And I thank Wadhwani Foundation for its pioneering efforts under NEN program to help facilitate entrepreneurs like you. What I have seen throughout my career is for any business to be successful, you need five things. The number one thing is a strong value proposition. Value proposition is what people see first or people pay money for. And that's what today, whenever whatever product that you see or whatever the money that you pay for that product is based on the value proposition that it offers to you. So if you have a strong value proposition, that will lead you to a pricing and that will lead you to a margin. It is not other way around that you will set pricing the way you want and then you expect customer to just buy the product. If today you can see a mobile phone industry that there are phones available at 5,000 and then there are phones available at 70,000 and people are buying both the phones with the only differentiator, the kind of value proposition that they pay. So if you look at the iPhone, because it has a strong ecosystem and that ecosystem gives lots of ease of use, convenience, power to the consumer, they demand high value proposition and they demand high price. The second thing what makes business succeed is continual stream of lead and business opportunity. So it's not just about having one time lead or having one closing, but continuously keep getting the leads and converting those leads into business opportunities. Third thing which is very important is cost effectively and consistently converting leads into paying customers. And then having a system to monetize the customer rather than just selling them one time. So for example, when you go to pizza, go to any burger, say McDonald's, as soon as you order your burger there, they ask you for a soft drink. So what they are trying to do is that they are trying to monetize you at that very instant. So how or what are you doing for your product or your business or your company by which fully monetizing the customer rather than just selling them one time or selling them one product and stopping it there? So suppose you are selling them a product, can you also go and sell them a service? And then the last thing is having a system so effective and so efficient that you are able to get more and more things done day in and day out. Normally we have seen that entrepreneurs get caught up in day to day, they get caught up in coding, they get caught up in fixing the problems, they get caught up in running operations, and then what happens, the whole business gets stuck or whole business gets into trouble. So these are the five factors that help succeed in a business. And with that factor of success in the mind, if you see, end of the day, business success depends only on three factors. The number one factor is, what is that interesting that you are trying to sell? Who is exactly interested to buy what you are selling and who is going to pay for it? Now, some of you will feel that what is the difference between buy and pay? So you take a Google or you take a Facebook, though you and I are using these platforms, so we are not paying for it. Some advertisers are paying for it. So, or when you are consuming television, then you are not paying for the content. It's advertiser who is paying partially, and partially you are also paying for it. So basically, in your business or in your scenario, who is going to buy it and who is going to pay it? So if you know these three things, that makes you to go and succeed in your business. Now, what I have seen is that when you look at the product, what do people buy? What do you buy? So you do not buy invention, or you don't buy creation, or you don't buy a very flashy message that someone talks as a brand tagline, right? You are not also buying the technology. What you are actually buying is the promise, or is the essence, or is the solution that the product is bringing into you. You are, every customer is looking at how this product can make them feel happy, satisfied, and give them the solution. And if you see the most successful products, like for example, when I see Nike, so if you see Nike throughout its history, it has never gone and said that I am selling you a very powerful shoes. It has gone and sold, or it has gone and promoted the athletes. And while promoting athletes, or while taking care of athletes, you and I have felt an emotion that this company can take care of athletes and sportsmen. It is certainly a good product for me as well. So every time that you see a player wearing a Nike shoe and running, you feel, oh, I can also go and use a Nike. So what happens is that it's people want to see the experience. Today, difference between a good restaurant and a bad restaurant is the food or the overall environment that it offers when you get inside it. So you are just buying an experience. So when you are putting your product, what is the experience that you are delivering to the customer? And while doing that, at this point of time, I would like you to ask yourself a question. Are you selling an experience? What is the experience that your customer can get from your product? Also, so around this today, we are going to demystify the whole thing that going forward, I am not going to focus on technology, or it is not about invention, because most of we say that invention is my USP, or technology is my USP, or the product is my USP. Actually, your USP is the craft, the connection, and the emotions, and the promise that your product or service makes to the customer. Today, if you see Google, the promise is that organizing information of the world. When you look at a Facebook, the promise is connecting people of the world, connecting people together. Now, after connection, people are sharing video, people are sharing their experiences, which is a different issue. But their promise is that they help you connect. Google's promise is that they give you, when you search, you get an organized information. So what is that in your brand? I think that becomes your core USP. And you can right now write down a 160-word tweetable tweet about the promise that your brand makes. Now, what has happened is the market is today flooded with a similar product from similar companies with a similar features, having similar things. And when they go and face the customer, or when you go and talk to customer and say that, hey, I want to offer you another product which is similar to something already existing, or customer is already using, or customer has found some solution, they start actually getting into very, very scary mode, right? They start feeling scared, they start feeling worried, their fear comes in a different form. So the number one fear that they comes, and they say that, oh, am I being sold? We all know what is happening when Eureka 4 salesman comes near to you. You know that this guy is just coming to sell you a product, whether you want it or do not want it. Making mistake, right? So sometimes when they buy your product, they know, is it going to work for me? Is it going to help me get solution to my problem? Is it really going to work for what it is designed? So they have fear of making a mistake while buying your product or service. Then the third thing that they do is they feel that, is this guy is lying to me? Because today, you know, lots of people say all marketers are liars, or salesmen are liar. So they feel that, are they getting, are someone lying to them, or is this company is lying to them? Then incurring debt, so people do not want to spend money, especially if you see our Indian economy, we have so much of cash, but our cash are hoarded in jewelry and in gold, so people do not want to spend money on transaction things. So also sometimes people do not have money, so they feel, oh, if I buy it, what is going to happen? How am I going to pay for it? Do I have to borrow from someone and all that? Then the fear of losing face. So if they are buying the product with some promise, say for example, I am buying something or I am taking my wife for a dinner and I go to the restaurant and it does not give the kind of experience that she expects or that I am telling, then am I going to lose my face? Then the fear of unknown, that how will I use it, how I am going to benefit from it and all that. Past bad experiences, prejudice, they also get scared the way you put the words about your USP or about your product. So sometimes you say, hey, everyone is catching up with a cancer and you can also catch with a cancer, so buy my product. Now you just scaring this customer about a cancer or about a diabetes or about a certain problem. So rather than scaring, you have to talk to this customer about how can you just make him aware. And making someone aware versus scaring someone or getting someone feel afraid is a two different thing. So if this is the premise from which the customer comes in, now how are you going to communicate with the customer then? How are you going to win the customer in your sales process? So the first and foremost thing is, and that's what you will see, the difference between a successful brand or successful company and a failed company is that all successful companies, they perform the promise. So if you are in a job situation and you are hired for a particular job, your success in the job solely depends on your promise to the performance. That yes, I have been hired for a particular position, I'm going to deliver it. Similarly, when you are going to deliver the product, are you performing to the promise? And you can see so many great companies around the world, whether you take it Sony or you take it Samsung or you take it Nike, Adidas, or whatever these brands, this Apple, Microsoft, even in India, if you see companies like in our own country, Asian Paints, if you see companies like VIP, or say a company like Tata Group, they all are designed to perform the promise. The second thing is pursue innovation. So market is changing constantly. Today, smaller companies are giving challenges to big companies every day. And when you are running your business, tomorrow you will become an old company. How will you stay ahead of the market curve? How will you keep exceeding or creating new kind of demand? So when Steve Jobs says that half the time customer doesn't know what he wants, how are you going to innovate and put the things in the hands of the customer that customer gets something by which they don't look for an alternative options? The third is committing totally. So are you confident that you are going to run your company? Are you going to give them the best thing, or your product is, will be available on a continuous basis or not? Then your product has to be easy. You can't expect, I have myself personally seen so many products, it takes a hell lot of efforts to use the product. The products like companies like Nokia went down, or BlackBerry went down, because it did not innovate. It made things a little complicated. If you see, at one point of time, BlackBerry was the most easy product to use. And it became most complicated because companies like Apple and Android came with a new kind of emailing interface, and it became much more user-friendly. Then the thing is, don't hide. So for example, if your product is not working, I built a company which was the first company to launch live TV inside the car, and the product was not working on highways. So when we used to sell, we used to tell customers that, sir, it will not work on highways because we do not have a 3G coverage there. So don't hide, tell customer the truth that yes, it will work in this condition, but it will not work in so and so condition, right? Then you need to guard your reputation. Today especially, because social media is available, people can go and put about you or about your business or about your product on consumer forums or Twitter in no time. You need to guard your reputation. You need to handle your customers very, very carefully. Then nurture leads into until sales closing. Most of the time we have seen that sales people especially, they will do few follow-ups and then they will put the lead into a corner because they feel they can't convert it. So sometimes you may not be able to close with a customer on time. Sometimes customer may not buy from you immediately. But if you keep on nurturing, keep on following up, keep on informing customer about the progress or the benefits, certainly the customer will come back to you at some point of time. Then have a integrity. I think integrity is a very, very important factor. If you commit, say, if you say, I tell you my own example. I think a few days ago I was at one of the health insurance company call center, and they are saying connect to Live Well or something, and I was asking for a customer service after having an insurance product for almost 8 years, and they were not even able to help me in the right way, and they then denied the whole thing. So when you offer something, when you promise something, don't pull back from it. Then pursue a value. Every business runs on a value. Tata Group runs on trust. Google runs on a certain value. Every company runs on certain value. If you must set a value for your company and you must pursue it, not just put it on your website or on your marketing collaterals and forget about it. And never ever fail a reliability test. So whenever you are going for a prototype, you are going to do a demonstration, or whenever you are going to showcase your product, see that everything is working. I have seen numerous examples where people say, hey, my product is working, but when they open the app or the solution, it starts failing. And then they say your server causes the problem, and hardware causes the problem, and this is causing the problem, and this is causing the problem. Never ever allow something to fail just like that. I thought I will bring this top brands of 2017, and if you see, these are the companies, they are bearish on exactly the things that we just discussed about. They offer integrity, they don't back out on their promises, they perform to their promise, they show and tell exactly and definitely what they are, and that's how they have become top brand in the global market. So how are you going to establish yourself into these slots going forward? I think that becomes your USP. Now, since we have spoken about USP, I would like to come and talk to you about how to go and decode the value proposition, right? So let's look at this format. It is actually a business model canvas which is available on internet. You all can download. What we are going to do is that we are going to look at this, and I am going to tell you exactly what you can do to use this one sheet to decode the value proposition or unique selling proposition for your company. So very first thing that you need to look at is your customer segment. Who is your customer? Because value for different customer segment varies differently. And to just give you an example, let's take a detergent, and let's consider Nirma. and Surf. Both of these products have the same function. Both when you use, they clean your clothes. But the customer segment for Nirma is poor and middle class or a lower middle class customers. But customer segment for Surf is a middle class and upper middle class segment. Today what happens is, I'm not sure about your business, but most of the time, most of the entrepreneurs, when I talk to them and I ask them about their customer segment, they say 7 to 70 year old. Now, it probably looks very exciting to say about that. But I have personally not found even one product, unless it is something that belongs to nature, like water and salt and food, raw food rather, and air, that has everyone as a customer segment. So if you look at Apple as a phone, has a different customer segment. If you see Vodafone as a telecom provider, has a different customer segment than Airtel, right? And that you can see in their commercials. One is aiming at youth, another one is aiming at matured business community. So you must narrow down or be very specific to the customer segment that you are addressing, and you should be looking at their demographics. You should be looking at their age. You should be looking at their income. You should be looking at their race. You should be looking at their cultural and habitual and culture and their habits. And based on that, you say that your product or your service is going to appeal very likely or most likely to this segment. And then for that segment, you should list down the value propositions. So when you are going to list down your value propositions, value proposition is not all about just talking about what are the features that your product has, but what specific problem that you are going to solve. Which kind of needs of the customer segment that you have identified that you are going to satisfy, and then you should list out what are the features of your product that is going to address the specific need of the customer. Right? So that's why the customer segment is very important. You need to spend a lot more time and go into a lot more detailing about the customer segment, and then you should be looking at the value proposition that you will be offering that very likely going to address the requirement of the customer. I am going to tell you a very simple tool today, so you will have an idea. Just write down your idea on top of this sheet. You can create this sheet. It does not take any rocket science. And think about 25 things or 25 features that your product should have that will help the person or the customer buy or use your product. List down all sort of things that comes into your mind. And just to make this list, you can do all sort of research. You can talk to your customer, you can see what your competition is doing, you can look at your own fancy and wishes, you can talk to your parents, you can talk to anyone required. But try to fill in as many as you can. So if you can fill 10, you can fill 15, you can fill 20, you can put 25, you can go more than that also. Right? And once you have done that 25 things, the next thing that you should be doing is list down the best 5 that you must do. Don't, because you can never, ever, ever communicate 25 things. So even if you look at Microsoft Word, which has got probably 10,000 plus features, we very prominently only remember 4 or 5 things. So we know that it helps us do a document process, document processing. It helps us format the document. It helps us save and export the document. It helps us edit the document, and it helps us delete the document if I don't want. Do I remember the thousands of features that Microsoft Word is offering? Do you remember? Don't. So what you do is that write down the top 5 features of your product which is going to be beneficial, or which is going to be the real value proposition that you are going to solve for the customer. And then you come back to this stage and just write down those 5. Now you can again go back to your customer segment that you have defined and talk to them, saying that, hey, I am looking at building this product which is going to give you 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 things. What do you feel? And the customer wants you to, yeah, out of these 3 are very important for me. Or they tell you, this is important, but I feel there should be another one which you are missing here. And like that, when you will start talking to your customer, you will find that out of the 5 best that you have decided, what your customer is talking about. And you can't just say customer very directly. You can ask his pain, you can ask his problem, you can do some kind of reasoning, and you need to keep on coming back to this until you find a very rock solid 5 value proposition for your business. So it's not just about you decided 25 and then you got 5 and then it is done. What you do is that you get a customer segment, decide 25 on your own, shortlist the 5, go back to your customer, tell them that exactly how this 5 solution that you are thinking will solve the problem that he is facing, or will give a better solution to the already product or service that they are using, and see what they are telling you. And once you have this, then this becomes your most needed value proposition or most desired value proposition in business. So what then you can do is that you can create a sheet called need, want, and desire. So need is something that must be there, and that need becomes your unique selling proposition. If you are not addressing the need in a right way, you do not have a value proposition. And then you can keep the want, which is the next phase to build after you have a minimum viable product. So lots of times people talk about minimum viable product, and they say build something and show to the customer, or show to your investor, or show to some stakeholder, and then if they like it, you go and build the next one. The minimum viable product that you are building should be built on these 5 features. The value proposition that you are talking to your customer, the unique selling proposition of your product that you are talking to your customer, should be this best of the best 5 things that you are going to offer through your product or through your service. Now, once you have got, and the other technique that I am telling you, that once you have got that 5 unique value proposition done, and you still feel that you may be missing something, so you can go and do a competitive analysis. I know that lots of you feel, lots of entrepreneurs have a reservation about talking about their competition or competitive landscape, but here what you should be doing is that you should name your 3 competitors, successful competitors, and find out the features that made them hit, and find out the features that they missed. And let me just tell you, at this point of time, recently I was talking to an engineer in Facebook, and he said to me that Facebook on an average builds 1,000 plus features every year. Do you remember 5? Or do you use 5? Do you use 10? Do you even notice those? We don't, right? But because they have engineering, they have money to afford, what they do is they build a feature, they bring in front of a set of customers, they see how customer is reacting to this. If they see the customer is reacting positively and it is taking some kind of virality, then they keep it or they push it then into the mainstream or they withdraw it themselves. But you as a startup or you as a small company may not afford that kind of situation. You can't experiment directly with your customers. So the better is that you look at your competition, look at the hits that they have done, look at the misses that they have done, and then go back to your five list and say, hey, do you still have the features which is rock solid compared to your competition? And then based on those five features or the five features that you have identified, what you do is that I am just giving you an example, say taking a mobile phone as an example. So the five key features of mobile phone is processor, memory storage, screen size and quality, battery life and camera. And when you have these five features, you look at the presentation, what if you see between the products, iPhone and Samsung, these all parameters put in a bottom and then putting rating between 1 and 5 about your product, you do the value curve analysis. Once you put your product versus the competition available, your idea or your unique selling proposition versus your competition, you will exactly be able to understand what makes you unique. What will put a glow on the face of a customer when you will talk about your product? What is the love mark that your product has? You know, and I am a big fan of this word called love mark. If you see, when you look at a person, we all have a likeliness for something. So some of us like eyes, some of us like lips, some of us like a six-pack body, or we like something, right? So that likability or that special feature, or some of us like dimple, right? So on the face, so that becomes our love mark. Your unique selling proposition is your brand or your product or your business love mark. And this blue ocean strategy based value curve analysis will help you understand the USP of your product. Right. Now and then I thought I will come back again to this. So you know that this is your customer segment, this is the value proposition that you are going to offer. Then when you are designing or you have to communicate your value proposition to the customer, and that's where you will give these two inputs to your customer relationship development department, which is primarily your marketing department, who will design the marketing, brand and business communication so that your value proposition is communicated in the right way to the customer, so that customer can create a binding relationship with your business or create an emotional binding with the product or service that you are offering. So today, if you look at, say, Reliance Jio advertising, it is always talking about youth to have this power of a digital in their hands so that they can do anything. So that's how they are communicating. They are saying, they are not saying that I am giving you unlimited voice, or they are not saying that I am giving you unlimited chat facility. They are saying I am giving you unlimited capacity to do whatever you want to do with your mobile phone or with your bandwidth. So you need to be very clever in crafting your customer relationship strategy, which has to be based on the value propositions and based on the customer segment that you are addressing. All the brands advertising today that you see, they all go and focus on this area, these two things, to develop their things. Similarly, then comes in the channel, right? So if you have got a product where your customer segment is very frequently going to a mall, then you will see that your product is placed in the malls that customer is visiting. If you feel that your customers do not go to mall but they go for a street shopping, then your product has to be available on a street. If you feel that your customer does not live in metro, but they live in a tier 2, tier 3 town, then your point of presence has to be in tier 2, tier 3 towns. So that's how you will decide your channel, right? That how will you reach out to your customer? If your customer is on an Apple store, then you will develop iOS application. If your customer is on an Android store, then you will develop Android application. If your customer is on an internet or on a computer, then you will be developing a web-based application. Right? So this is how it is going to be in the channels. And then you will be designing the revenue. That how will you charge your customer? What will you charge your customer? Because you know your customer segment, you know their affordances, you know that what they can afford, what they can pay, what their paying capability. So based on and what kind of value that you are offering, so you can decide on your revenue stream. What will you charge one time? What will you charge? What will be your pricing strategy? At what level you will be giving them discounts? At what level you will be giving them other benefits or loyalty programs and all that. So primarily, if you look at unique selling proposition, is all about defining your value proposition so strong that your customer segment finds it adorable or connected to them, and then your marketing communication, your sales communication is designed to communicate it in the right way, and then you have product placements and product pricing designed to or defined in a way that it is clearly understandable by to your customer. And that is how you are going to benefit from defining or keeping your customer proposition in the right way. I think at this point of time, I would like to mention to all of you that I am a part of NEN mentoring program, and I'm available online on their platform for mentoring. If you have any question, you want to have any further consultation, you can certainly connect with me there. I'll certainly offer you my help or my support for you to get your answers or help you find your answers that can help you develop a better selling proposition or a unique selling proposition for your business. I have been aggressively mentoring, coaching, working with entrepreneurs. I run a series of programs in different cities. So and I am an open networker. So if you want, you can connect with me on LinkedIn and we can stay in touch together. And you will get an idea on the programs that I am doing at different places. You can join me also on a face-to-face basis. I also keep on doing webinars. I will keep on doing webinars with the NEN platform. So I think we can certainly interact, engage, and help augment a right and more successful entrepreneurs in this country. That's how I would like to conclude my talk today. And I'm open to questions. If you have anything, I would love to answer those. So it's now over to you.
Request participants to send across your questions via chat, and Ishwar would take it one by one to answer them. So please feel free to interact with him and clear your doubts, if any. Thank you. Ishwar, I have already shared with you one question which has come from Nitin.
Okay.
So the question is, sir, we want to know the future home inspection startup in India.
Future
home inspection startup.
Where can I see the question? I can see the question. No, I can't see the question.
Yeah. I have shared it with you. You can see it in the chat box.
Chat box, I don't see anything.
I've already shared it with you.
So can you repeat the question once again?
Nitin Shingote asks, we want to know the future home inspection startup in India.
Home inspection startup. So what is a home, when he's talking about home inspection, I'm not able to understand exactly what is home inspection. Is it verification surveys? Is it monitoring surveys? Is it a guarding service? What is it?
Nitin, what I suggest is that you can raise your hand and I can unmute your mic so that you can connect directly with Ishwar. Okay. Please pick up, Nitin, please pick up.
Yeah, Nitin, we can hear you.
Go ahead. Hi, sir.
Hi.
Hello. So you're hearing me?
Yeah, I can hear you.
So we have just launched a startup. The name is Measurement. Basically, we find out the faults and the issues in home, the real estate industry, where the buyer has purchased the new home, but they know the exactly condition of a particular home, whether this carpet area of the particular flat is okay or is lesser on the as per the agreement. Is the all amenities are provided as per the registered agreement? What is the condition of particular plumbing lines, wiring and all that? So we have find the faults in the particular construction on the behalf of the owner before taking the handover of the particular flat from the developers.
So I think certainly there's a, just 1 second. Yeah, so actually if you see this space, there's certainly a gap, there's certainly a market need for this. But again, if you see, say places like Metro, Mumbai especially, right? So there are lots of
Mumbai
apartments. So if one verification happens, everything else is sorted out. And people will go that, yes, for me everything is satisfied. Or everything is better, then other people will believe them. But the small towns where there are lots of bungalows and lots of individual independent apartments, probably there it could be a good service.
Okay. Yeah. Thank you, sir.
Yes, welcome.
Thank you, Nitin. Any other? I have questions from Vishal, Sanket, and more, so I'm just few of them, I'll just connect you to them who have raised hands. Otherwise, sure. I'll just read out the questions myself.
Sure.
You can please speak out.
Hello.
Yeah, hi.
Hi, Ishwar sir.
Hi.
So, I want to ask you one question. Actually, I am from rural area. So, how we can target the rural area audience if I want to start up in spices business, like whatever the mustard or like that kind of product?
So you want to launch a startup for spices, to sell spices,
Yes.
And you want to position it for rural area, right?
Yeah.
So if you see, I think I have some rural background because I belong from a village. Now people across country are buying ready-made or ready-to-use spices. People do not want to prepare themselves except few places. So certainly, I think there's a prospect to launch a spice business. Only last week, I met someone in Pune, and they were saying that he runs 900 crore turnover company by selling spices. Right? So, and that too in a bulk. So it's certainly a good market. It is going to be a successful market, because if you see last 2 years, Tata has launched a spice brand, and then Baba Ramdev has launched a spice brand. And what I have got to learn from the industry that both of them are doing pretty well. So if you have something unique, if you have something by which you can create a proper cost benefit advantage for the customer and offer high quality, genuine spices, I'm sure there is a market for that.
Yeah, thank you.
I have a question from Sanket Mishra.
Okay. Yeah, Sanket.
Hello, Sanket. Okay, so the question that Sanket asks is that, so I have a business model that will boost up Indian approach, new track, to use your time, expense and technology. I have the model, say concept. So he was discussing something like that. Yeah, Sanket, can you speak up?
Hello?
Yes, Sanket.
My voice is going there? Yes, my voice is going there?
Yes,
yeah, I'm hearing you. Please speak up.
Hello?
Sanket, hello? We are able to hear you.
Hello?
Please
my
speak
voice?
Our question.
Yes.
Yeah, we are hearing
ma'am,
you,
I want
Sanket.
To ask that. Yes. I want to ask that I have a business model regarding the car concept of automatic car washing. We are five group of five people. We are everyone is here engineers and all are dealing with them concept of automatic car washing industry. So how can we decide in the people mind that this is the better choice than any other roadside car washing services?
So you have to show, right, rather than tell. So,
yes.
So for example, so for me, I think I will create a demo station and tell customer to take their car there and show them how their car is washed and looks clean and looks better. And the customer will notice that, he's certainly going to keep coming back to me rather than going to the traditional car wash centers.
Yes, sir. We have also a pre-concept car of car refueling and detailing inside all over the only one stop, only on one stop, sir.
Great. So what is the problem? So if you have a concept which is easy, convenient, and which is going to solve the problem of a customer in a better way, you should certainly
go and launch it. Sir, yes, problem is nothing, sir. We are in the, sir, we have all the blueprint, we have prepared for all of that, all the requirement is there. Talk to the, sir, some developing person, but we require some shortage of funds, sir.
Okay. So, what you can do is that you connect with me on a mentoring panel of NEM. Okay.
Yes.
And then we can talk about your plan. You can share with me your pitch deck. And I also put my own money, and I also have dozens of friends who invest in this kind of ideas. So I can connect you to them, and you can talk to them. And if everything goes well, you can certainly get funded. Getting funded is not a problem. I think today having a good idea,
yes,
having a good team, and having a good business plan is important.
No, sir, I just want to ask this only, sir. We have a concept, sir. We have only a card, fully car detailing business, a triple HO generator, which can increase the life of a car by 30 to 35%, decrease the noise by 50 to 70% by this generator.
Okay. Great.
Yes, sir.
So I think you connect with me on a WF NEN mentor panel, and we can take it up
okay.
from there.
Okay, sir. Okay, sir.
Thank you.
Okay.
Thanks.
So Ishwar, there is another question from Jyotishman Goswami. The question is it possible to receive or listen to the copy of the the first half? Okay, Jyotishman, I'll send you the recording of this webinar, and also the presentation is there in the handout, so you can just download from there and view it. So there's another question coming from Sambit Mohanty. At what time should one be concerned with product market fit?
So product market fit should be the so there are a couple of things happens. One is product market fit on a very day one when you are launching your product. Then when you go and take your product to the market, and customer keeps on coming back to you saying that, hey, this should be more better, or that particular feature will make it more useful, then you have to start innovating and building them. But every successful product keeps on looking at their product market fit almost every fortnight. So today, if you see any mobile app store or any computer software or even a car companies, Earlier, car companies would launch a new model after 5 years or 6 years. Today, they are launching new model every year, or they are launching a new variant every 6 months. So what is happening is that customers are now feeling that earlier customers used to feel, say, and I think a very specific example of car market. So earlier when we used to buy a car, we would say, oh, this car is on the road for 5 years, it is now proven, it's sturdy, it has a low maintenance cost, so let's go and buy it. Now the mindset has changed that you need to buy what is the latest. Because you get latest technology, you get latest features, you get fuel efficiency, you get better cost. So I think the product market fit right now or in the current context is not a one-time job that, oh, today you have achieved product market fit and you can now keep on monetizing. You have to go achieve, attain and innovate your product market fit almost every day, almost every week, almost every fortnight, every month, every year. This has to be ongoing basis, but if you are just thinking of starting a business, I have already explained you the template. Don't launch a business unless you have validation from your customer. So you go and look at 25 things that you want to do, shortlist 5 things. With that 5 things, go to your customer segment, talk to them, tell them this is what I want to offer you in replacement of or something new for your car. And the other guy was just talking about the car cleaning or car servicing. So if you can, and if they tell you that yes, this is perfectly fine and I would love to buy it, you know, the another check that I want to tell you guys at this point of time is customer will tell you, yeah this is super. Tell him that, hey sir, if I bring this product to you today, will you pay me 10 rupees or whatever the price that you want to do, and then see how his face color changes. If he says you, yes, sure, I would love to do, ask him for a contact details and then see what, how his face changes, or does he give you or not give you. I think today product market fit is not about whether I am feeling the product market fit is there or not. It's more about how customer feels that your product is product market fit. And if you can, and I think that has to be on a day one for sure when you are launching a business, and when you have launched your business, it has to be a continuous effort.
Sure, there's a question from Jagdish A. How different vision statement is with respect to value proposition?
Which statement?
How different vision statement is with respect to value proposition? Vision statement.
Okay, vision statement. Okay. So, you know, so vision is something like your existence. It's like Tata Group says the vision of Tata Group is trust. It does not say that I will give, and that trust is translated in the products that Tata Group builds. Whether it is building a steel or it is building truck or it is building aircraft or whatever. So trust is an inherent value that. Your vision is a ultimate. I call it supreme moment that your business talks about. A value proposition is, or a selling proposition is, a very very defined benefits and outcomes that people will experience when they will buy your product. So for example, if I am buying a Tata steel rod today and putting it in my house, it must build a solid structure, but whether it's trustable or not will be proven 20 years from now. And that's why I see the vision that Tata Group says that I'm a trust company. That means if you're using my rod or my iron for building your house, even 20 years later, the house will be equally strong and comfortable and to give you a safe living inside your house. That's how I would like to differentiate it.
Ishwar, there are the two participants who are asking your email ID so that they can share their business model, which they do not want to take it up in this platform. So if you are comfortable, you can share the same. I have suggested them to come and register on WFNEN, where they can come and connect with you. So exactly. Alternative, you, yeah.
So yeah, so they can connect with WFNEN, and they can also connect me on LinkedIn. I'm available on the same name, and then we can start communicating from there.
There is a question from Mohammed Khalil. So he asked that I'm about to launch a book very soon on everyday productive performance. So he wants to have your review on the book and asks that how can he send the same to you?
Again, connect me on LinkedIn, connect me on WFNN. You will have access to me. You can send it to me. I actually, because it is a WFNN platform, I do not want to put my personal email ID or my contact details. But I am on all social platforms. You guys can track me or get reach to me in 2 minutes from now. So just go on Google, search my name. You will find me there. Connect me, and I am available. I am open networker. I respond to all the queries sent to me within 24 hours. So it's a very simple logic I have. I am here to help. I am your extended hand, and trust me, my supreme goal or supreme purpose is that I help 10,000 entrepreneurs to become successful in this country. I myself am an entrepreneur. I run my own business. But my realization today is that I am a better Chanakya than being Ashoka. Now I'm looking at Ashoka in all of you. And if I can be a good Chanakya, it's more than a welcome step thing for me.
That's so much. Yeah, that's a fabulous thing, Ishwar. So participants, if you have any more questions, please send it across through chat. We are going to end the session soon. So please send out your questions as soon as possible. Ishwar, I am not seeing any more questions coming in, so maybe we will end this session for today. And if there are any questions, I'll send it across to you so that you can like answer them.
Yeah.
So concluding this webinar on demystifying unique value proposition, it was a pleasure having the webinar session with Ishwar. I truly appreciate the way you covered each and every topic in detail and also cleared our doubts on the same. I would like to express my appreciation to the participants on behalf of Wadhwani Foundation, National Entrepreneurship Network, for your dedicated participation on the webinar. We will be having another webinar series shortly and would like to bring to you another enriching experience. Wish you success in your endeavor. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Rosna, for being such an awesome host. And we look forward to working with you more in future. Thank you, everyone. Thank you very much.
Thank you.